All school stakeholders, students, teachers, parents, and community members really want the same thing, success for all students. Most of our energy and focus in schools today is on the interaction between teachers and students, and far less attention is spent on parents, families, and communities. We know that when schools develop strong partnerships with parents, families, and communities, that students achieve at a higher level and they're better equipped for lifelong success. Parent and family engagement in schools has really shifted from a nice thing to do to becoming an essential component in helping all of our students succeed.
Important for me that you know the families that you're working with. I remember one teacher saying, introducing me to her husband, and she said, "This is Gail, the African American girl's mom." Now, I don't refer to myself as African American, maybe because I was born and raised in the Caribbean. I'm a naturalized citizen, but I refer to myself as being Black. Mm-hmm. And that's how I refer myself. So I said, "I'm not African American, I'm Black." And the teacher said, "Oh, I never know what to call you people." And I said, "Well, now you do." There are significant differences with even Black people. If you're speaking to a Black immigrant from the Caribbean or Africa, there's certain similarities. We're all Black people, but there are cultural differences and mindsets that are a little different and unique. I think it is important to see that identity. I want to be known by my particular country. Oftentimes, I've heard educators say, "We don't see color." And it's like, why? I see color, you know? And there's nothing wrong with seeing color. Seeing color, it doesn't mean you're prejudiced. It just means you can see. It's not bad that you see me as a Black person. I want to be seen that way because that's who I am.
I think that it's important for him to know about his culture for his education too, because I want him to have pride in his culture and to share that with other people, because education is a two-way street. You learn from others and then you also teach others, and that's really important. I feel that for his education that he gets to know other cultures and teach about the other cultures, because it gives him confidence when he goes out. There was no curriculum about the true history of Native American culture, so I think it, and I think that's what causes problems. Once you figure out or learn about another culture, what you realize is that we're a lot more alike than we are different.
It's important for teachers or educators to understand that they're dealing with a diverse population in their schools, and that each student has something valuable, and that they need to honor that in that child. And so maybe instead of just looking at them as 26 kids in a classroom, looking at them as individual people with their own cultures, their own families, and then maybe going a little bit further and trying to honor who they are.
When Indian education is not present in my child's life, I feel that she is not connected and she's not learning the things she should be learning. She's not learning how to be a good Dakota. She's not learning how to interact with other Native kids. She's not learning the tools to help her succeed in the education system as a Native American child. We have been so beaten down because the system was not made for us. The system has failed us because the system was not made for minority people or people of the minority. The system was made for white males. And so now they're trying to fix it and keep putting band-aids on it, but it's not going to work. It doesn't work for us because it's a system that's flawed. I guess to succeed in that system, I don't know what it means. It means that you succeed in the white world, but does it mean you succeed in your culture? Does it mean success for you and your people? That's a hard thing to figure out.
He must have heard something.
She knows that she's Dakota. She's proud to be Dakota. Another huge part of historical trauma is boarding schools. And
what was the regular lunch?
The fact that
we don't have
the government would allow churches, or even the government itself, would take children from the reservations and send them to these schools. And literally beat their culture out of them. And a lot of students died away at school. They never made it back home. And so I think what's part of my historical trauma is, as crazy as it sounds, every day when I send my daughter to school, I don't know what's gonna happen there. And I'm scared that she won't come home, or that something will happen there that I can't fix, or I can't change, or I can't make better. It's a feeling of powerlessness.
The touches that took place when I was in school touched me in a way that told me that I wasn't as valuable. And those were biases. It was because I was Black. It was because I was a slower learner, because I couldn't concentrate. It was all those things. But if I go back, it's interesting, and people are like, you do what? I'm like, well, I manage budgets, and people cannot believe that I did, because they saw me with through these lenses. I think it's hard for people to understand that every time they touch that child, they like leave them with something.
Like you were in bed last night?
As I watch my sons grow and evolve and deal with the biases, I think it's so important for the education system to really understand their touches, how important those touches are. Every one of them should leave the child feeling confident. You have this thing in the back of you that you know that the educational system isn't ready to deal with your son, and you're worried about those touches. And I see it happen. People treat my son really well, but I see other places where that doesn't happen.
Culture is very important, and it's something that is not always taught in school. It's a subject of a lot of our own learning at home. I'll talk about where my family came from. For example, my dad grew up in the South, have descendants of slaves, and I mean that's one subject in history, but I want my kids to know more about that and more about their selves and where we come from. So I think the school can really help in that area by including different diverse cultures, by bringing in speakers from the community to talk about their own stories and their own history. One thing I've noticed a lot in the school is just the effort to be politically correct and not offend anyone. And it can get to a point where all the different diverse aspects of life and culture just get watered down to the point where they're not really learning the differences. If it's a Christmas party, we'll just call it a Christmas party and let the other kids share in that culture, and you can also teach about other holiday traditions from different cultures. That it's okay to show diversity. We're all different, and kids need to know that it's okay to be different.
I've never met a parent or family that does not want the best thing for their own children, both in school and in life. Parents and families have the greatest impact on their own children's future through the modeling that they do, the expectations they set at home, and the support they offer their children in the home environment.
So something that I'm really proud of as a parent with our son Gavino is he's very active with going to Chinese school, with Taekwondo, with drum and dance group, with his dancing, and that's a lot for a four-year-old. Spoke down to him as a child, but we always spoke up to him like he was an adult. Just the fact that he knows that he has two parents that love him and care for him and instill a confidence that if he is having problems at school, that he tells us when we're on our car ride from home, "Mom, somebody said something about me being a girl because my hair is long."
I said, "We both know that's not true." I said, "What did you say?" He said, "Well, I told him that I'm Oneida and that's my culture." And I thought, whoa. I said, "Well, that's a good answer." And I thought to myself, that's a very diplomatic answer.
Education doesn't mean just Gavino being in a classroom, but it's in every part of our family life. It's in the things that we do. It's taking a walk in nature, talking about the things that we see, talking about people. So it's on and beyond a classroom.
It's important for me that my daughter understands her cultural identity because that is who she is. She is a Dakota woman. And she is all these things. And she needs to know how to behave as a Dakota daughter, a Dakota sister, a Dakota cousin, a Dakota granddaughter. And that is who she is. That's her identity, and that's how I expect her to be.
How my parenting affects my child's education, I think, drastically. Early on when he was in kindergarten, he just did not connect to the classroom setting at all. Didn't pay attention, was sort of closed, and he hated school. The bus would come and he'd bust out of the house, run down the street so he didn't have to get on the bus. He really did not like school for a long time. And it took, and as a parent, I had to spend time understanding that. What were the forces? What was going on? It really sort of boiled down to that He told me one day, "I just don't understand at all what's happening in the classroom." As he kind of second, third grade started to find this out and then decided that we needed to get some testing. It's very difficult for him to just hear information and understand it. He's got to process it. Whether you call it ADHD, auditory, but I want to be careful because at the same time, there are assets that come with that. He sees the world through a different lens than other people. He kind of reads between the lines, and he sees humor and things that others don't. He's an amazing artist. So he is a unique learner, but he's not an uncommon learner. But the school district just hasn't figured it out yet, and we're helping the teachers figure it out. That's what we tell them. I think healthy parenting is doing your best just to really look at your child as an individual. And as opposed to attached to your esteem. And then from there, it's just giving them every little piece of positivity that can just, so they have fun. Just don't want him to think that there's anything that he can't do.
We
We have, Lacey and I have three children. And our eldest is 24, mm-hmm. and our youngest is 11.
We have instilled in our children that they are basically born to solve problems. So, in other words, they have a destiny. They're called to something. And we don't know, we're not going to tell them what it is, but there's something in this world that they're called to solve. And so, as parents, we believe that we are trying to, in our own efforts, trying to help them find out what they're called to solve. It is a process, becoming a healthy parent. I don't think anyone really arrives because you never really stop parenting. In that process, you gain more freedom, you gain more security, and you begin to have open communication, not only about your successes, but also your failures. You know, you're willing to come back to your children and say, hey, you know what? When Dad said that, he shouldn't have said it. He shouldn't have yelled. I apologize. To me, those things wrap up some of the essence of a healthy parent.
The school is a big part of education, but parents are key in contributing to the education, developing the habits of a study, helping the kids understand the importance and what it means to have an education and what is not. And also just creating the space for education to happen.
We try to do things that help them be authentically themselves. So we watch where they're interested in and then try to support that area of interest.
Trying to leverage what they're doing good too. Of course, there's areas of opportunity for all of us, but trying to leverage what they're really doing well and what drives them too. So I think we're trying to be deliberate about it. I think the other piece too is about the joy of learning and, you know, the importance of building good habits, of doing a good job, but without putting the pressure of trying to be perfect. If you enjoy art, that's great. If you don't enjoy math as much, do the best that you can. Do a great job. But if your passion is art, it is okay. You have to follow your passion. My dad was a CPA, and he had his own firm. And something that I respect and I really appreciate from him is it would have been very easy for him to tell me, why don't you follow my path? And I already have the business and I have the clients. I can mentor you. But he never put that pressure. He always said, what do you really want to do? So, of course, I never became a CPA. You know, in the school, they plant the seed. But I think as parents, it's up to us to water the seed.
Learning doesn't stop when school's not in session. It's an anytime, anyplace sort of thing. Parents have the ability within their own power to continue the educational process at home by reinforcing the things that were learned in school, but also providing enrichment activities that extend learning for their own children.
Because I'm from another country and the extended family is very important to me, I do spend a significant amount of time sharing with my children my upbringing, my cultural views, what it means to be Black in America. I believe it takes a village. And I, on purpose, created a village for my children. I created that village to help me with that learning, to impart people that had like values, like expectations. And so I surrounded my children mm-hmm. with these mentors. if there's a situation where Lacey and I are speaking to our children about something and trying to help them along in an area, I call out the Army. And I believe there's safety in the multitude of counselors. And I will call out my reinforcements to speak the same language, because I trust them and know they will, to help with my children. I really am thankful for, very, very thankful for, that my children has people in their life that they can call on for help.
For me, learning in the home means that it goes back to, it's how we've always learned and taught traditionally in our culture. You learn from your parents, your grandparents, your older siblings, aunts, uncles, I mean, grandparents, everyone. So for me, learning in the home means that you learn how to be, how to act, and how to respect.
I remember my father was always telling us to be open-minded. Listen, I had a brother who was one class ahead, and then my sister was two class ahead. So my father was always allowing, he wanted us to to collaborate. You, Richard, my brother was Richard. Richard, you held Patrick on his weakness on math, because my brother was, oh my God, he was genius on math. And then you, Grace, you're good in language. So he taught us how to collaborate with one another. And then the same way, my kids also, I passed them to them too.
Read loudly.
Look at a group of
youth. This right here. Yes, it is a climate, exactly.
Bridget, she's getting a lot of help from my brothers, because sometimes the way they teach over here is totally different from the way we learn when we're young. So her brothers and sister, they went to school over here, so it's easy for them to teach me, try to help her more than we do.
You read and then you practice, you understand? You read and then you practice, you understand? Why that? We raised our daughter Bridget with all the kind of values we as Christian would love our daughter to grow up with. And so we also tell her all the time that respect is very, very important, regardless of age. So your own friends as well, you have to respect them too.
Learning in the home is us baking together and him measuring stuff. So much of the learning happens in the home, in our house. Even just how to negotiate relationships, how to, just because I say no, it doesn't mean no. If you come back to me nicer, that's education. That's how you reframe. That's how you create relationships and not have things be so black and white. His homework, it's more about his environment. So how do we keep his room somewhat neat? Not because I'm neat, because I'm not particularly, but if he goes into his room at the end of the day and it's really messy, that adds to his disorganization. So he might have a tutor that he works with one day a week on organization. Not so much, he might have a math tutor, but really it's organization and organizing your mind to get the work done. And that's, so I really want him to understand that it's not organizing because mom's all uptight and neat freak, but it's organizing so that he can, in his own, develop his own skills to manage information.
I think learning at home is very important, just to cover all of those topics that aren't always covered at school, or at least not as much as I'd prefer. I guess I like aviation and science and space, so I know they have science class, but I like to give the kids more of an opportunity to share my passion for those subjects. And it usually happens at bedtime for us. They'll just be thinking they're watching a cool video, and they'll ask me some questions about it, and I'm actually teaching them about the Doppler effect and different specific science topics. So when it comes up at school, well, they already know all about it, and they can tell the teacher what they know. And
they do.
There are topics that I feel are important for learning in the home, social skills, just learning how to interact with people. Sometimes if we'll tell them something that they don't want to hear, or ask them to do something they don't want to do, they can, you know, yell or just say, no, they're not going to do that. And that's not always acceptable at school or later in life when you get a job. You can't just not do something. And the other important topic is cultural and just space. You know, I'm African American, and my wife is not, so
I'm white and Mexican.
Yeah, we get the questions about, you know, well, you know, somebody asked me, what am I? And, you know, a teacher at school isn't going to answer that for them. So, you know, basically we let them choose their own racial identity, but just to hear our stories and how we identify ourselves and what our cultural background is, that's something that they're not going to learn about anywhere else than here at home.
My aspirations and dreams for our children as a learner are to reach their full potential, you know, live up to their dreams, be what they want to be when they grow up. If our son wants to go to Mars, I hope he learns and goes to school and gets to go to Mars someday. As a mother, you know, I really don't want him to, but if that's his dream, then who am I to stop him?
My aspirations and dreams for my kids as learners is that they can embrace learning as a lifelong process.
Better decisions are usually made when all stakeholders have the opportunity to offer input and be part of any decision-making process. Parents and families want to make decisions. They have much to offer, and they should play a key role in making decisions on important issues that impact their own children.
Oftentimes, I think parents want to be part of the process but don't know how, or maybe don't even know how to request what it is they feel they need, how that process works. Mm-hmm. And schools are probably a little bit more intimidated about having parents dictate or tell them what they should do and how they should do it. But I think it really helps in building that community to have parents on you know, that parental voice in the decision making, and especially for parents who like myself, mm-hmm. when I first came here, not knowing the system at all. At least I spoke the language. Mm-hmm. I think for parents who don't speak the language, that might be a little more challenging. We are not currently a part of that decision making. They are making those decisions. Now, you know, there may be a parent advisory group, but we're not part of it.
In our case, I think we're on the sideline.
We're not involved.
We're not involved at all.
They do involve us, but maybe not the way we would love to be involved. You know, they will tell you some, but not everything. I mean, it is what they decide, what they do. They'll send you maybe a newsletter about the board meeting, what they decided. So that's how some people feel like you're on the sideline, but we feel like we wish we could be involved more. They do involve us on decision making, when it comes to, like, let's say grades, pretty much they will discuss you how they will discuss with you where she is, what need to be done, and sometimes they give you a choice. If they see like she's not or he's not doing well, they'll give a choice, maybe as a parent, what you want to do, you know. So basically they involve us on those decisions.
Some of the decisions that they make on behalf of myself and my child, I think that where he should be at in certain areas in his schoolwork, maybe not allowing him to excel if he needs to excel, and waiting for other kids to catch up. The decisions that are made by the school should be made by the parents and the teachers together. I mean, they should work together to make these decisions. Nobody knows my son better than us. So I think it's got to be a joint effort to make it really work. Sometimes, especially with native children, they assume right away that maybe they're not very good at math, or maybe they won't like the sciences, and they make these assumptions. So they're making these decisions, and they immediately put them, you know, at a lower level instead of challenging them and making them rise, you know, to the occasion, make them better at math and better at science. They're not given the same type of maybe respect that other kids are given. I think that they really need to take a look at that and change that.
Sometimes there's an assumption made, and in this community it has as well, when if you're a minority family, that your child will automatically need extra help. And I talked to some families in this community where they're from Pakistan and India, the parents, and they were sent a letter that was saying that their children had qualified for the special program. And basically it was a program that was for children who need catch up in academics. And it was totally not relevant to their children's situation. And they actually took quite a bit of offense, and some other parents did too. And so I thought, isn't that interesting? That kind of presumptuous of that the school would just, I mean, and we didn't, and then I was kind of like, why didn't we get a letter? And how did they define that?
The process in which my daughter's school makes decisions makes me feel like I'm sitting on the sidelines. They just make decisions and then everyone has to fall in line. One of the biggest decisions that the school makes for me or for my child on behalf of me is that they are teaching them how to be. And it's not always how the family or the home life wants it to be. One thing that pops into my mind with my daughter is when we lived together, like, she would always hold my hand and walk next to me. And then when she started school, it was, okay, I'm the line leader this time, and you're the line leader next time. And, like, I was like, well, we can just walk next to each other. But in her mind, like, she was already picking that up. Like, someone has to be the leader, and you can't walk next to each other. I would like to be involved in decisions that are made in my child's school that have to pertain with Native Americans. So many things are mistaught in school, and I would like to go in and discuss those things with the students. They're at an age now where they are questioning things, and they are thinking more critically about America and the government and everything. So I would like to be more involved that way.
And then you're done with math for the year.
When my daughter was learning about Abraham Lincoln in school, they kept talking about how wonderful he was and how he freed the slaves and what a great person he was. And my daughter told me that she said to the teacher, well, Abraham Lincoln killed 38 Dakota men. And the teacher's just like, oh, okay. And, like, didn't say anything or react to it. And I remember my daughter being, like, confused. And she's like, I don't know why she didn't say anything to me or why she didn't talk about it anymore. Because my daughter knows that history. And So all I could do was tell my daughter, well, you did the right thing, you spoke up, and that was the important part.
The traditional view of parent volunteering is for parents to join the PTA, chaperone the spring field trip, or to help teachers in the classroom. All schools have parents and families with a wide range of skills and passions who are ready, willing, and able to help in other ways as transformational leaders, school helpers, or peer-to-peer partners.
I'm current PTO president in the Parent Teacher Organization. I do a lot through that. We have a carnival every year that I'm on the committee for that. We're in the process of building a new playground. I also volunteer at the school in two kindergarten classrooms every week. I go in for about 2 hours in the afternoons.
My volunteer efforts at the school have been relatively limited compared to my wife at the school. I go in during the PTO meetings and will help watch the kids while they're having their meeting there. But I'm also a pilot and I like aviation and flying and science and things of that nature, and I haven't really seen many volunteer opportunities that relate to that. So some of the opportunities I wouldn't say are directly related to what my main interest is. I guess, for example, if they had some type of opportunity for me to teach about flying or teach about science or something along those lines, that would be something I'd be more interested in.
Our oldest daughter is going on a school trip next month. And, you know, as a fifth grader, usually they'd be like, you know, don't talk to me, Mom. And she's actually very upset that neither of us can go with her. So I think that's made a big difference, having us so involved. They're not embarrassed by us because we're there all the time. So everyone knows who we are. And, I mean, 10, 11-year-olds are at that age where they're starting to get embarrassed by their parents. And we haven't experienced that yet. So I'm sure it'll come eventually, but it hasn't yet, and I think we're very fortunate that way. For me, these volunteer experiences are meaningful because I get a better chance to connect with my kids. It gives me really good insight to them, their friends, their school, what's going on in their lives. I think I get a perspective a lot of parents don't get by being in the school so often. And seeing them amongst their peers and in their learning process. If you're not involved and engaged with them, you really don't have an idea of what's going on in their lives anymore. So that's why I really enjoy being involved and seeing it, seeing how they're growing.
I grew up in the island of Trinidad. In my growing up experience with school, parents did not attend school. There were literally no parents involved at my school. Parents made sure their kids went to school, and there might have been a parent who ran a tuck shop, which is your equivalent of a cafeteria that sold candy, but there weren't any parents at all. Teachers would understand, not because a parent or family member can't be in that school or that building to help in the classroom or in the district or whatever. It does not mean that that parent doesn't care. Mm-hmm. It does not mean that parent isn't interested in their child's education or have dreams and aspirations for their children. Because there are so many different situations and scenarios today that parents aren't always able to, mm-hmm. to, I mean, my mother wasn't, and she was a teacher. She wasn't able to come and volunteer in my school, or that was no such thing. But even today, I can't get there as often as I'd like. So I think that's another thing, that there's other ways we can engage. We're in the technology age. There's other mm-hmm. ways to engage with families and not to be afraid to do that.
The way we're engaging, we parents in school, for instance, sometimes Bridget, she goes to all these field trips. And then ahead of time, the school sending us email, any parent who'll be able to volunteer, you know, blah, blah, blah. That is very good. As a matter of fact, before I was like, that's not me. That's not me. Or even to go to their lunch. I'm trying to go, wanted to go and volunteer. They have like security when the kids they're playing outside, especially this time of the year. They want parents to volunteer, to kind of like, walk around the yard, protect the kids, just probably half an hour, 45 minutes, and then you go. Is that the fact that my time is very limited?
Our school's really good about soliciting involvement and volunteerism because our community has skills.
And they're also very organized because at the beginning of the year, you get a booklet with all the options where you can volunteer. And it tells you the committee, it tells you how many hours are required, and what are some of the skills that you need. So you have a big booklet of options, and you might not be able to do it every week, so there's some options where you can volunteer once a month for an hour. So all the options are there. So I think they're really, really good about doing that.
I think our community, we're lucky in that we have, it would be interesting to hear the statistics, but very engaged parents. And like Joaquin said, they send out the volunteer things. Some volunteer positions are, a lot of time commitment, but they really do a good job of saying, if you could just come in once or twice in the whole school year and do this, that would be great. Or if you could just volunteer at one recess, especially in the winter when no one's volunteering. So there's a chance for any parent to just do a very light volunteering or, take on a big job like, head at running the PTO or something. Right.
And I think the parents most parents are very involved, but they're involved as much as they can.
I think volunteer experiences are meaningful because you have teachers really see you as helping. And other kids see parents, and there's a sense of community that happens. And everything is about relationships. And by volunteering, you're able to just sort of multiply your relationships and then multiply and leverage those relationships for change, good sorts of change that need to happen, both for you as well as the school district, or maybe even the teachers, a teacher setting. And then I also were able to connect with other parents.
Schools are part of broader communities that really have similar goals as schools. Our communities are full of individuals and organizations with assets, resources, and talents that can and should be utilized and leveraged in ways that benefit our students, our families, our schools, and our communities.
The school is so connected, and in our situation, very connected to the community as far as extra things that are happening in our community. It could be some community education events. It could be, celebrating a new garden in our community or something, that the school's connected to that. Our school's really good about soliciting involvement and volunteerism because our community has skills. There's people who have skills, finance skills or fundraising skills or whatever. And so they're really good at soliciting that. Like, we could use help with this. Right. And parents in general, many parents are interested if you throw out a need and they have a talent in that way, they're happy to help. The schools do a really good job in this community just having partnerships, I guess, informal or formal, with other things that are going on. And I think the kids see that.
Local business people around the area, I think they do a good job of helping the school. Some of them, I think they just give in like free coupons and, that kind of motivate the kids to do stuff, knowing like, okay, we're gonna get free coupons. They have, sometimes they'll bring like a guest speaker, like a counselor or like a psychologist, like somebody who can come and talk about different topics, how to raise your kid, how to talk to your teenager's kids, and they usually invite parents to go. So usually it's a meeting between parents and the kids can go too. So they do that maybe 3-4 times a year where they invite these guest speakers and they come and talk about certain different topics. And I think that's very, very good.
Most of the parents, we go the same church. And then let's say if we do have these Bible studies on house to house, sometimes most of the parents, we all meet there. So, and then, our kids go to the same school. So it's kind of like we interact more in church rather than school.
Partnerships that are really important for our kids' school, I believe number one is involving parents, you know, getting them involved beyond just the normal email and conference. You know, if you're not taking time to find out the student's background, if their parents are both involved, if grandparents are raising them, you know, and digging a little deeper and finding out, the teachers aren't going to know as much about that child and how to reach them. Also getting community involved and say, like there's been police officers that have come in and done talks and firefighters that have come on in and done talks. Just, you know, small things like that where they can see positives in their surrounding community are important to them so they can see that they're safe and that there is a broader area than just their walls of the school, that they live in a community that they're have to function in, and that's important.
The connections that I feel are important for the school to have are those that deal with diversity. Just bringing more cultural diversity, economic diversity, so they can see different places, talk to other schools that are in different areas, just so they can get a sense of the differences in people and also the similarities, so they can see that. As parents, we don't always have time to take them everywhere, so if they can gain some of those cultural experiences at the school, that's a very valuable experience that they can have.
Well, as a principal, I like to get out into the community and connect with families, so I'm here scooping ice cream, chatting with families, talking to kids, meeting with parents, socializing, so it's a great opportunity for the home and school community to connect with one another.
So ways teachers can get, you know, kids' cultures involved and help them learn their identity is to involve the families in dialogues about what their culture is. You know, if parents want to come in and share their culture, if they have a different culture.
I just remember when I was going to school, you know, I was the only, or one of the few African-American kids in the school, wasn't a... the neighborhood that I was in was very few minorities, so I was one of the few. So I didn't always feel connected to the school. A lot of times I felt like an outsider, so I didn't want my kids to have that experience. So I tried to keep them involved as much as possible, just so that they feel comfortable wherever they're at, that they're part of the community.
It would be fascinating to see a school that has a broader connection to other educational institutions that are higher. So no longer will you see sort of our high school and our junior high sort of off by itself, but you see it attached to the University of Minnesota or some other colleges, so that learning becomes, it becomes part of the fabric. You know, you don't graduate from high school and not see the next opportunity. It's already networked and a part of what you're doing. You know, I think the fundamental partnership that schools need to have is really with parents. Don't get me wrong, I know you see models out there with the clinics and the social service providers and the food shelves and the, and I that's beautiful. I mean, but when you miss the fundamental partnership with your parent, all of that sort of is null and void. You know, you have parents that need to be engaged in reading, writing, understanding what's happening in the classroom setting, supporting their kids. I mean, education for your child is great. Not necessarily the healthcare provider. In those communities that they really need that, absolutely. But fundamentally, I want their partnership to be with me.
It's hard to establish good relationships of any type without effective two-way communication. Open communication is as much a mindset and an attitude as it is about the mode of communication, its frequency, and its quality. Communication is about both receiving and giving information and input, and it's about working together for the benefit of all parties involved.
Good communication looks like open and authentic communication. That's what it looks like to me. I tend to like to hear it straight. If you want to sugarcoat it, it's okay. But I don't like to read between the lines, personally. So I prefer just to hear, this is what's happening in the school, this is some areas of opportunity, let's make a plan about it.
Our school, I mean, what I think they do well is they're very welcoming. I felt welcomed when we started the school. Even before the school year started, we had like popsicle social or, you know, emails and letters. Like, that's the other thing I think is important. Coming at parents, not bombarding, but in different avenues, they involve parents in engaging new parents to the community. So I think the tone is set from day one. There's a genuine feeling, at least I feel that way, that they care about us and they care about our children and that they care about our voice. I feel like I could call the principal on Monday if I had a concern and she would take my call or call me back very quickly. I feel like I could talk to or connect with any of my children's teachers, and I believe within 24 hours I would get a response.
They usually do.
We do.
They usually do.
And I was just saying an example the other day. My daughter, my youngest daughter, was going to school, and she thought she was going to an after-school activity that she's been really excited about, and at midday it got canceled for some reason. And so I was really concerned about her being confused, A, about where to go after school, because I was saying put her on the bus instead of what she thought was the plan. I was concerned she'd be confused, and I was concerned she'd be just emotionally sad because she's excited for this event. And I called the school, and she said, no problem, we'll send this, we'll send someone from the office down and talk to the teacher, and we'll talk to her, you know, my child. And I thought, oh my gosh. Right. I just thought that was, you know, outstanding.
And as Melissa said, I think it's a partnership. You know, they set the tone too. So it's kind of like a little bit of working together.
I think I would want to know what's really going on in the classroom, what's really going on with Gavino, not things that I want to hear, but things that I need to know as a parent so that I can get involved.
With my youngest daughter, we had a situation when she was in high school. She was talking about her Ojibwe language class was her favorite class. One day she came and she told me that she got a new instructor. Dad, I tried to tell you, my Ojibwe language teacher doesn't speak Ojibwe. I know more Ojibwe than he does. And we went to the principal, and he seemed to understand. He was the only one to understand, but we went to the superintendent, to the school board. They told me, well, Mr. Lemon, there's only a couple months left in the school. Why don't you just let it go? I said, if that classroom was full of non-native students and they wanted to learn how to speak Spanish or French, you wouldn't put a teacher in there that didn't know how to speak Spanish or French. We end up going to Washington, D.C., and we talked to the people that funded the program in the school district. And after we did that, then they finally decided that they were going to remove them out of the classroom. There was a major communication breakdown there with the school and the parents, because some of the parents didn't even know what was going on. And the communication is a two-way street. The parents have to be involved, and they have to come and talk to the teachers. They can't just drop the kids off at school and say, well, the teacher's going to educate them.
We all have our roles and responsibilities, but at the end of the day, what matters most is the child.
I moved my son to Wilshire Park purposefully because it wasn't diverse, because I could work with a teacher and deal with issues and to be able to connect and get in and meet with the teacher and meet with the dean and have those open door policies. And that's what keeps us here. There's things that you can't believe he doesn't understand or he doesn't know. You'd be like, dude, no, you get that. And he'll have this look in his eye. And I've come to understand that there's a lot more that he doesn't connect, that your average person connects. And teachers had a hard time with that.
So which of these lines cross at positive 2 on the y-axis?
He has got to know, because kids know this. And so really working with them so that they didn't start to penalize him for behaviors or actions. But he doesn't really know. Even though you probably told him 2 minutes ago and maybe told the whole group 4 times 3 minutes ago, he didn't connect with it. And having them sort of, and giving them an out on it, not saying that you're wrong, you don't get that. It's just like, this is a process, and there's no way a student wants to stick out. And he is embarrassed by sticking out. Most people are a little embarrassed by sticking out in that way. What we did was really pull the teachers in early and the principal and say, we really, he's going to be successful here, but he'll be successful if we have support. And then making sure those things that happen in the school setting, I actually would take to the principal first and then talk to the teacher about. You're not there to badger them or belittle them or to do their job at all. But my son learned a little differently. And they've come to really appreciate that and be patient with it. You just stay with it. You just don't give up. You rest is what we say. You rest when you get tired, but you don't give up.
My 17-year-old daughter was in kindergarten. She was a very quiet child. She came home one day and asked if we would invite her kindergarten teacher home for dinner. And we weren't really sure how to respond to it. But I didn't want to say no. And so I decided I would extend the invitation. And her kindergarten teacher said yes. And my daughter came home and knew what her teacher's favorite meal was, what her favorite drink was, what her favorite dessert was. And so we prepared just that. And I remember her teacher being shocked that this very quiet child who probably, she knew her, but I don't think she knew as much about my child as my child knew about her, obviously. And so I think that was something new for that teacher. But I think she learned a lot about us and about Joelle that evening by spending that evening with us. And I think it does make a difference in you realizing that maybe people you think you don't have much in common with or you don't have similar backgrounds, that when you do get together, you find out that as human beings, you have a whole lot more in common than you think. When you're working with different types of families that look differently or speak differently or do things differently, that it's an opportunity for growth. It's not a barrier to overcome. Yeah.